during the course of the morning, an example of a few SOAP messages that are sent to retrieve information back from UDDI as well. Okay, so why UDDI? Like I said, there are many registries out there. There are also some proprietary registry notions. You can build your own registry very simply if you can come up with a model of how to store information, right? ANDI is a registry, right? The Java naming, the CORBA naming service is a registry, so on and so forth. They're all registries of some kind or the other, right? What we are interested in is certainly platform independence. So the fact that it is based on HTTP implies that we don't care about, you know, how this is being stored. And there's a very nice abstract model that is defined for UDDI, as a result of which everybody has to conform to that abstract model, no matter how UDDI is actually implemented, right? Remember, UDDI is a specification, it is not a product, right? So because it's a specification, you have to somebody has to implement the specification and deploy the server somewhere. Only then can you register things into it and can you look it up, right? So that's one thing, and it's an open standards process. However, UDDI is not being managed by W3C. It started out being managed by W3C, but because EBXML was being managed by OSS and they already had a bunch of other stuff going on, the UDDI effort has moved off to OSS as well, which is another standards body which works closely with W3C. So this is what it enables: dynamic service discovery. If you didn't know where the service was running. And one of the questions that came up yesterday was, you know, how far can we carry the notion of dynamic? Right? So there are two aspects of dynamic. One of the aspects of which was demands, or we showed you the code yesterday of dynamic dispatch, where you know what the service is, but you don't know where it is. Right? And you'll go find, so you're looking for a particular service whose description you know beforehand, a priori. Right, and you don't know where it is, and you find it out through a directory and then dispatch it all dynamically. The stronger or the deeper aspect of dynamism comes from I don't know what the service looks like as well, right? But that's a much harder proposition to deal with, right? It can be dealt with, but significantly harder. Now, whether it has any practical use when you don't even know what it looks like is being questioned, which is why right now, mainly UDDI supports the notion of the first aspect of dynamics. It will give you the whole description, it will give you the WSDL. The question is whether you can construct the service request from that WSDL without human help. Right? Okay, so what does UDDI contain? UDDI contains many different things, like I said, not just service descriptions. Right? So it contains businesses and other service providers. In other words, information about the business. What's the name of the business? Where is it located? What are the contacts in the business, you know, all of that information is contained. And we'll take a look at the model. What are the different services that this business exposes? For each service, what is the binding? Or where is the service running as far as this business is concerned? And then the different WSDLs supported by each of these services. So registry data can be divided into these two blocks, if you will. The first block is just business registration. Right, business registrations are, the businesses will give information about themselves, right? Nobody else can give this. Also, the standard service type definitions is created by some standard organization, right? So there is something called a T model within UDDI, and different T model definitions which can be standardized beforehand, it can be standardized by some standards organization. Like what is a PO, for example? The type definition for a PO may be common across most industries. It could be standardized and dumped into UDDI as well. And everybody can refer to the same notion of a PO if there's a global registry that is available. Right? By the way, there were some organizations and still are some organizations running global UDDI registries. IBM was one of them, which just got shut down a few months ago. I don't know what the reason was. No reason has been given on their website. Then Microsoft runs one. Then NetObjects runs one. So we can give you the handles to some of these global registries if you want. Take a look at that. Okay, so how is data organized? Data is organized in many different ways within this. So the two kinds of data that you saw on the previous slide can still be organized, can be sliced in different ways, right? So that you can look it up differently. And this is very, very similar to how your phone directory notion is organized, except that we'll add one more concept to it, right? If you open a standard phone directory, there will be white pages and yellow pages, right? In fact, there is also something called pink pages. I don't know whether we have it here, but governmental organizations, you know, emergency services, etc., are listed upfront in the directory separately. Ambulance, fire, hospitals, airports, things like that, right? So they are actually listed in what are called pink pages, at least abroad, and they are listed prominently in the very first part of any phone directory that you can pick up, so that you don't have to search through this thing at all. And then there is the standard white pages, where if you know the name of a specific entity or a specific person, you can get their phone number, right? And then there's the yellow pages, where if you know some of the attributes of what you're looking for, you can get information about them. I'm looking for somebody who will supply plumbing material, you know, 4-inch pipes or something like that. And then you can look under plumbing, and then you can look under plumbing shops as opposed to plumbers, and then you can kind of drill down there and get information about them. That's what this means. So this is organized very similarly as well. There's a notion of white pages. So if you know the name of a business, you can say, go get me the handle to the description of this business, right? Then you can drill down and get more detail upon the business, and then you can start drilling down from there. So the business exposes services. So there's a containment hierarchy within UDDI, right? That containment hierarchy will allow you to drill down if you get to the top level of a particular business. So you can say, get me the services, for each service, get me the description, get me the location, binding, etc., etc. So that's the white pages. And there's the yellow pages. The yellow pages are basically going to be based on certain attributes. So for example, categorizations that you're going to create. Again, so the question that came up a couple of days ago as to whether we can put categorizations. This is where you would put it. You wouldn't put it in the service, but you would put it in the registry, right? So there are some standard categorizations that are defined in the West, at least. So there are industry codes, for example, that are defined in the United States. Then there are ECMA codes, location is one way, etc., right? So where is this particular business located and so on. But you can create any form of categorization that you wish if you control the directory itself, right? And put it in there. Yeah.
So they are X.500 based directory service for identity management.
Yeah.
How can those be integrated where we are talking about the business identities and...
They can be integrated. It depends on what you mean by integrated. You can possibly build your UDDI implementation to go pick stuff off of an X.500 structure, because this contains similar information too. You know, information about the business, business descriptions are also part of UDDI. So you could do that. It's possible to do that, but you would have to build that yourself. So your implementation has to, you know, do that.
Some of those are proprietary nature, identity management, directory services, like from
Microsoft. Right. Yeah. So those will probably not expose APIs. So that may be a problem for you to integrate with. Okay. So the yellow pages are basically focused on attributes, not of services, but of businesses. Right, so I can find something based on the type of business that I'm looking for. And then the green pages are actually based on technical information about the specific services themselves. Right. So give me some service that has an SMTP binding and then also has an industrial categorization that does this. You know, could be an example. So you can search based on both kinds of information, and we'll see one such example as well. So who are the people who use UDDI? Certainly anybody building a client will use UDDI because they are the service consumer, right? So a web service client. You can either browse a registry. In fact, there are popular browsers that have also been written to go look at registries and present information in a tree-like manner to you, right? So that you can, for a human to sit and consume. In fact, the IBM registry has such a browser attached to that. So it's kind of unfortunate that they have pulled it offline. Maybe it's temporary. Hopefully it's temporary and they'll put it back online so that you can see what such a browser would look like, right? And the clients will then pick up the service description, then create a proxy, right? Or a stub, as we called it yesterday, right? Certainly somebody has to publish information to that. As far as UDDI is concerned, even the service creator is a client into this, right? So it's no different for UDDI. And that will generate WSDL and it will construct all the UDDI entities.
Sir,
Yeah.
In the previous slide, talking about the technical information.
Right.
So if you have multiple registries, and if I want to publish my service in all the registries, and do they all follow the same some kind of standard for these for a particular identifying a particular service?
We don't know. It's not necessary. Right? It's not necessary that all directories are going to represent the service in the same way. So, this is typically what happens. I have a slide that shows that. What happens is that some kind of a standard description for a particular kind of service is put into what is called the T-model aspect of UDDI. Okay? This is not specific to a business. This is just across all businesses who are going to provide flower delivery, we will create a flower delivery notion. So this would be a consortium of florists, for example, right? So just like there's a consortium of chip companies, semiconductor companies, which have created all these standard descriptions of services that they offer,
right? So you have to have some kind of domain standards which can be...
That would be a situation where this would be most useful. If you had a domain standard specific, so say, to the financial domain, to the verticals, or whatever vertical you're dealing with, right? Now what happens is that that model has been published into the directory, right? It doesn't mean the service is available, just the model of the service has been published into the directory. Then individual businesses, should they happen to offer a service that is compliant with that model, will put out an entry saying, here is a binding for a service that will conform to that model that somebody has published here. And you will give a pointer, specific pointer using a key within UDDI to that model, so that many service providers will all provide services that are compliant to that particular model. They are just running someplace else and they are different service providers, they are differentiated through quality of service or whatever other means. Remember the very first day, the first session when we went through what is a service. It's a standardized description exists. That's why the notion of dynamically discovering what a service looks like is not as useful, is what I meant. Right? If you have a standardized description of a service, and implicitly that's what, you know, that's the way we work as well, right? So if you think of a any kind of a service, if you think of a transportation service or a logistics management service, somebody who ships parcels for you, a courier company. All courier companies do the same thing, and that model is fixed in your mind. You know what a courier company does, right? So you call this person, he'll come pick up a parcel, deliver it, deliver an acknowledgement back to you. Right? That's a standard model of that service for you. So from that perspective, we want to replicate the same notion here. So the model for the service has been standardized and put out there. And then all you need to know is which courier company to call, right? And so for that you'll search based on many attributes. So does this serve my area, how much do they charge, what is their efficiency, what is their reputation, whatever. Right? And then you'll call the person and you'll use that service. It's a very, very similar analogous notion here. So there is a standardized description of a service that has been put out there by some kind of a consortium. Right? That has been formed that is specific to that vertical domain. If random descriptions of the same kind of service are being put out there, it will make life significantly harder for everybody. Right? So that's not. So if two courier companies work entirely differently, then it would confuse you also as a human. Right? So this is the same notion here. If two services were described completely differently, it would confuse the client, the consuming client. Finally, applications that need dynamic binding. So we've kind of already seen through this. So the last line here there says that the query can be pre-generated. This is what we showed yesterday, the notion of the dispatcher, where the query itself was generated as a string. The SOAP message was actually encoded and kept as a string, except that we didn't know where to send it to. Right, and that was found out dynamically and then shipped. If you take a look at the adoption strategies, typically this is a phased adoption approach. Right? Very rarely would anybody want to go to put a public federated registry out there for consumption by the rest of the world. Right? So of course, phase one is just learning. You'll figure out how to, you know, use this effectively. But this is where your first step would be phase two, is that you will have a private UDDI registry for that organization, right, that's available only on the intranet. So So there is restricted access to this, in other words. If you have restricted access, the advantage is that this notion of standardization you can do within your own organization. It's not hard to do that, right? So there may be many departments, all of who needs to share the notion of a customer. Right? The customer should look exactly the same across all the departments in your company, no matter how large your company is. Right? In which case, you will create a standard description of some kind of a CRM service that everybody is using. And any other service that consumes the customer information has to draw out of this description or conform to this description, right? So this is typically what you'll see today, which is why we don't see too many public registries. So the next step is that there are many public registries that are out there, but they are not actually truly federated. What do we mean by federated? They are working together as a single entity, sharing data. And different pieces of data is resident in different directories actually. But I can query any directory and it will go, if it doesn't have the information, it goes and queries the other directories and comes back to me with the information. That would be a federated directory structure, something like DNS. If I query my local DNS server, if it doesn't have the information, it bumps its query up to the next level DNS server. That doesn't have it, bumps it up to the next level. So DNS is organized as a tree, a multi-rooted tree. Right? So there are 7 root DNS servers in the world, and eventually they will have the information propagates within DNS, right? So if you, suppose I set up a new machine today on IIT and put it out on the internet, now how will somebody else know of that machine? That DNS entry that is going to be made local to IIT will propagate to the next level. There may be a DNS server from Maharashtra, then it will propagate to India, then it will propagate to one of the root 7 root DNS servers in the world. Right? So somebody searching from Australia for this machine would then first search within their campus, say Sydney or whatever, and if they don't find it, that gets bumped up. Finally, it will find it in the root. Or if the root doesn't have it, it propagates the search back down the other branches of the tree that it has. Right? DNS is organized in a very specific tree-like hierarchy. So that is what we mean by a coordinated or a federated system. So no matter where I initiate the search, I'm guaranteed that DNS will find this for me if it is out there, right? So that is phase 4. It's a federated public UDDI registry. So there can be replication of data. In fact, there probably will be replication of data for reliability purposes or availability purposes. But this, we are still a long way away from this. We don't even have a discovery architecture that has been outlined. So this needs a discovery architecture, in other words. How do I propagate the query? Where will I do replication? How much replication will I do on such a system? All these harder issues have to be resolved, none of which is, unfortunately. Right? So this, it turns out that we are doing some work here at IIT Bombay with respect to phase 4. So we have created one such discovery architecture for semantically annotated web services. Right, so web services with semantic information, and we are in the process of writing a paper and sending it off in the next 2 months or so. Right? But again, this is research; it's not yet out there for people to use. Right? Finally, there may be value-added registry services which goes one step beyond this and can offer other forms of search, and may even do negotiation on your behalf. It may do selection on your behalf, it may do rank ordering on your behalf, all kinds of things. So if there are 20 services, will I just return a bag of 20, or will I return them rank ordered in some way so that I can pick it based on a profile that it has of me? Right? So that's the notion. So maybe there is the notion of relevance. What is relevance? What is relevant to me may not be relevant to the next person, or it may be a different relevance to the next person. So this is what we mean by value adding. You can think of anything here. I mean, the list is limitless, and if you can provide such a registry with value-added services, you can make a lot of money in the future. It's a business opportunity for people. Okay, so what does UDDI look like inside? What are the different entities specifically that exist within UDDI? Right? So first of all, there's a business itself. It's called a business entity. It's a provider of some service. It is usually registered with respect to, it's available or searchable with respect to a white page lookup. You can actually also find a business entity based on certain other criteria, but this would be the standard way. I know of a specific business, right? And the business service is some collection of related services that exist, within that business, within a context of a business. Then there's binding templates, just like you have seen earlier for WSDL and for SOAP. So the notion that the service is running on some particular port and it references some specific technical model, in other words. Right? So the technical model says what the service description is, an abstract service description. This is what we meant by a standardized service description. Right? And we'll see some examples of this as well. So that is a technical, the next notion is that of a technical model or a T model. Right? So it's a reusable concept. Once I create such a T model for some entity, then it can be used by everybody who's using that registry. Right? How do I find which the unique T model entities is a notion of a key that we'll see. Right? Let's forget this. Relationship between businesses can also be captured in this. So it's some kind of business networking information can be captured in this directory as well. We are not so interested in this at this point at least. Right? And then subscription. So UDDI actually has API when you can say, you know, subscribe, I'm interested in any business that comes up that deals with this area. And if it's, if somebody registers with you, let me know. Okay, so here are the core entities. So we'll forget some of the subscription part of it, the relationships between the businesses part of it. But this is what we are going to focus on for today. Right? So there is the notion of a business entity. And the business entity provides a business service. The business service can be available at different binding templates. Maybe I offer different protocols at different ports. I can be accessed in many ways, is what I'm trying to say. But typically, if it is a single business service, it will be corresponding to some T model entity that's out there. T model entity is actually a description of that service, right? So this is ideally this would be standardized and reused. Remember, we had the abstract description of a service and then the concrete binding in WSDL. So this is the abstract description, if you will, right? So and you can have many different business services that this is offering. So there is a containment hierarchy as well as a concept in here. Okay. So. Yeah.
The top one.
Hmm.
This business service has got two binding templates.
Yeah.
And that is organized with two different models.
Right. In this case, it is different. Ideally, it won't be like this. This is just, it's not representing anything real. It's just a picture. Ideally, you won't have a situation in which the different binding templates are compliant with different interface T models. It doesn't make a whole lot of sense if I were to do that. If it were a single business service,
yeah,
it would not do that. Right.
Is that number of courier companies would follow same kind of model?
Correct.
So is this T model same as that description?
Yes. So ideally, that we'll see towards the end of this talk, this session, what is the standard way of using UDDI? You know, how would these different entities use UDDI? Right. So yes, it would ideally be the T model that is shared by all the companies in a particular domain. So if we are talking of financial domain, there could be further classifications in financial, you know, stock traders versus banks and so on. But all of them would share T models corresponding to services that they provided. You know, so online stock trading service, portfolio management of some kind, whatever. And there may be some set of services. But all of them do the same thing, whether you go to ICICI Bank or whether you go to HDFC, your online stock trading services and online stock trading service. It's a very, very standard notion.
T model for one kind of service.
Yes, so your online stock trading service will have a T model.
Exactly.
That they will be put into a registry. If they're all sharing a registry, so much the better.
Yeah.
Right? And then ICICI Bank will have its own implementation of that service that is running somewhere. So that will be advertised as a business service by ICICI Bank, which is a business entity. Same thing with HDFC. HDFC will have its own version of the online stock trading service and so on.
So can we say that a model corresponds to a category of services?
Not necessarily category. Here the category may be financial stock services.
Yeah.
So category, categorization is a notion where you can club sets of services. So if I want to search and I don't know exactly what is the service I'm searching for, I'm saying return all services within the notion of stock, something to do with stocks. So that's a categorization notion, right? So the T model could be placed in a particular category, as we'll see, right? Right now, there is no mapping of ontologies to UDDI. Yeah, I think we discussed this yesterday a little bit. But the next version of this, if you will, is going to be semantically aware, right? When it is semantically aware, that means that it is going to be tied. So rather than just saying that this message is going to take this particular type of information, I will relate it to a concept in some ontology, right? That way, even these descriptions can be related to concepts in ontologies.
One is the concept in the domain, another is the service itself. That itself, you could have an ontology for the service itself?
No, well, there is no ontology for the service. There is no such notion.
Something, maybe some metadata describing a particular service.
Yeah, that is available even here, already available within
that
UDDI.
In one of the previous slides, we wrote. Right. Meta information on WSDL
right.
documents.
Right, it will be there. So there would be English language descriptions to say what the service is like. If it can be consumed by human, it can do that.
At this moment, can we talk about that? Yesterday we talked about orchards and flowers.
Hmm.
So is that the same one when we talk about meta information here or not?
It could be, absolutely it could be. So you could say that I'm a florist but I only sell orchids. You could describe that restriction there. Yeah. But it's not formalized, unfortunately. So it's a description that is free text, right? As a result of which, it's not a formal entity that can be consumed by another computer program and made sense of at this point in time. That will change once we tie it into ontologies.
So if you look at that contentment directly, it would be something like T model at the top.
At the bottom.
Businesses.
T model at the bottom. So the T model is first put out there. Right, a business is going to offer many business services. Every business service may have multiple bindings, right? But a business service corresponds to a particular T model that is out there. Right? The T model can be reused by many business services, right? Each business service corresponding to a different business. So top or bottom depends on how you look at it. But yeah,
that business service itself could belong to multiple T models.
No. Business service is conformant with a single T model. Yeah. It can't be, it's not a one-to-many there.
And T model is created by some consortium.
If there is such a consortium, great. If there isn't, and if you're a big company, you create your own T models and deal with it. I mean, how it is created is a different thing. This is what it offers as a capability. How you use this capability is a good way to use it, and I'm sure there are many ways to use it. If it is domains, first of all, today there is nothing available, unfortunately, so there is no confusion. But if we come to a position that many people adopt this standard and start putting registries out there, then we would like to avoid a situation in which the same service is described in 10 different ways by 10 different registries. Certainly we want to avoid that situation.
How about one registry? If does one registry expose so that within at least its own registry it can say that these are the service providers for this?
That's the whole point of UDDI, right? Is to say that there are 5 courier companies offering courier services, all of which are conformant to this T model. In fact, that's exactly what a UDDI query will return, right? It will return a list of business services to you, right?
And the business provider will then register for one of those services.
No. The provider is the one who's putting it into the directory in the first place.
Provider is the one. See,
right.
I'm the first provider for courier service.
Fine.
I register. The UDDI doesn't tell me that these are the services which will be offered through this. I mean, these are the services.
There are T models. There is not services. There are T models, right? Is there a T model already corresponding to this kind of a service? Is the first question you ask the directory. If there is no T model, you can create your own and put it out there. Right? And then you will also register a service conformant with that T model, which basically says that here is a binding. This means this service corresponding to this T model is available at some port.
Okay.
Right. We'll see examples of that.
So I had one more question. The relationship between the business service and the team model is 1-to-1, as you say. So then what's the relationship between the binding template and business service? I do not understand what does binding template mean.
Now, I can offer it at different ports with different protocols. So I can offer it at HTTP port 8080 on some server. Some URL is going to be given there. I can offer it via SMTP and somewhere else.
So the binding template is based upon a team model.
No. Binding template is tied to a specific team model. It's actually the business service should be tied to a team model. This diagram is not entirely correct.
One business service is tied to two teams.
Yeah. We just discussed this earlier, right? We said this wasn't a true representation of what's going to be out there. We will see. XML documents, it shouldn't arise, yeah.
Service provider has to register all the UDDI directories or the public directories?
Well, if it is a federated system, you register somewhere, the registration will propagate, like DNS. If it is not federated, tough. What can I say? Right? So, we want to get to a scenario wherein we have a worldwide federated set of registries, like DNS. That's our ideal model. Are we there? No, is the answer.
Are there any efforts in that direction?
Efforts are there in that direction, clearly. DNS also evolved. On day one, there was no DNS. People were struggling. Finally, they all came together and said, here's a smart way of doing things. They came up with DNS, which works beautifully today. You don't even realize that, you know, when you do a IP address search from a URL, you might be going halfway across the world to find out where that IP address is. You don't even think about it. It's so transparent to you. Right, so that's what happens when you type a URL in a browser. A URL is a name, right? So www.yahoo.com. What does it mean to a computer? Nothing. So it has to translate that to an IP address. Where is www.yahoo.com? Is an IP address on the internet that is unique on the internet, right? How do I find what that IP address is? Go to DNS. That's my first thing that I'm going to do. So where is the DNS? There'll be a local DNS server. Remember, when you set up your PC, you'll say, where is DNS? That's the first thing you have to say. Otherwise, the PC will not pretty much work, right?
So I think that EVXML to provide support for distributed service,
Support is provided by everybody, but you have to create such a structure. Just because the fact that there is support, does the structure exist? No. So support is provided even by UDDI to do the federation, but doesn't mean there is such a federated set of registries available in the world. It's not there, right? So somebody now has taken the trouble of defining these 7 root DNS servers and maintaining them across the world and all that. Who maintains these registries? Nobody today. Eventually somebody will pick it up.
Since there are no W3C standards for UDDI, everybody getting T models, won't it lead to chaos and standards?
No, that's what I'm saying. We are actually dumping to the last slide in the presentation, effectively. But what will happen likely, right? How many of you here have heard of Rosetta.net? Nobody? Okay. Rosetta.net, just to kind of divert from the topic, is an industry consortium of semiconductor manufacturers. AMD, Intel, Sun, IBM, there are thousands of smaller ones, Xilinx, you know, all these guys out there. It's an industry consortium who got together and said, listen, we're all buying and selling similar stuff, right? So we have to buy silicon, we have to get wafers done out of it. Once we get wafers, we are going to make chips, and then we have to sell the chips to each other. Some people may customize these things, whatever, right? So all of them deal with the same domain, in other words, right? Semiconductor manufacturing is the domain, right? They got together and said, if we are going to be passing around the same information, what's a wafer? Let's define what a wafer is. And let's all use this definition, right? Otherwise, if each one of us define what a wafer is, it's going to be a pain in the neck to deal with the different definitions. So they got together as a unit and they came up with a set of definitions that they called Rosetta.net. And these definitions were created in XML and made public to anybody who wanted to interact with the semiconductor manufacturing industry. They made it a de facto standard, right? There was no standardization organization, right? So they said, if you guys want to talk, anybody out there in the world wants to talk to us as a group, right? or as an individual, you have to use this standard. Otherwise, we are not going to listen to you, is what they said. So that will have to eventually happen. Right? If that doesn't happen, there would be chaos, but out of the chaos will be born order eventually. Right? So if there is chaos long enough, people get sick and tired of it and fix
but
it.
That will lead to proprietary sort of things if
no, it's not proprietary. If every semiconductor manufacturer follows the standard, what's proprietary about it? That's okay. Right? So the notion of a purchase order for a semiconductor manufacturer is defined. It may not be the same thing as a purchase order for if you're buying marble to construct a building. Maybe a different thing. But that's okay. So all the civil contractors may get together and define their own this. But at least now you're dealing with two forms of purchase order as opposed to 20,000 forms of purchase order. It's a good thing.
What is the monetary benefit for that Rosetta Notebook?
Monetary benefit is it avoids chaos. Imagine the amount of energy, resources, people, computing power that was being consumed just dealing with these different definitions.
Does different companies give something to them? I am talking about the monitor.
No, the Rosetta.net is not a physical thing. It's just a standard. It's a de facto standard.
I am again coming back to the same thing. If I am the I'm a manager of some web service, I will publish into it. What is the monetary benefit for the OSS that manages build?
Oh, there is no monetary benefit for those people, except they'll probably charge you something to publish it eventually. Right? So if I set up a public directory that I'm going to let you use, then I will probably charge you something to publish information. Right? So do you pay the phone company to list you in the yellow pages? You do. Absolutely you do. A business is not going to get a free listing in the yellow pages. You got to pay the phone company. Same thing. Nothing comes free. No free lunch. Okay. So moving on. I think we have covered the last third of the presentation anyway. So we just have to cover the middle third and we're done. So what are some of the key design principles in here? We have the notion of keys because we have to uniquely identify many entities out here. Key models, business services, everything is assigned a key. Right? If I register a business, it gets assigned a key. I can register the same business again, it will get assigned another key. So you can do that. Right? So the keys are either assigned by the publisher or are generated by the registry. Certainly uniqueness has to be guaranteed. So there has to be some way of ensuring that you know the uniqueness is maintained. There's a notion of containment. We already saw this, right? A business has business services and so on. Every business service can have multiple bindings, whatever. So there's a containment hierarchy, right? So the keys inside these elements are either referring to that element itself, right? Or it is referring to some entity that the element is referencing. And again, we'll see examples. I think it will make it much clearer. So there can be a collection, right? So the notion of a container implies there are collections. Because a business can have n business services, that's a collection. And then you can have many different optional attributes. And we'll come back to this example. You can don't have to worry about a specific example here. Right? Okay, so here is a pictorial description of the structure of a business entity. Right? Let's take a look at the structures of different things that we have seen so far. Right? So a business entity, what this is saying is that, okay, there are some ways of interpreting this. It is made up of, right, all of these. Some of them are optional, some of them are compulsory. It has to have a name, it has to have a description, whatever. So the plus here indicates that it's a complex structure that you can drill down into and find out what's underneath that, and we can explore that complex structure. And then there are some standard notions. So you got to have at least one name, and you can have many names, right? So this 1 to infinity means you should have at least one name. 0 to infinity means it's optional. I don't necessarily need to have a description, right, of this particular business, but you could have many descriptions if that's what you wanted. Contacts, and then contacts can be drilled down into, so on and so forth. Right? Don't worry about the identifier bag and the category bag for now, but the category bag is a way of categorizing the service, the business entity in this particular case. Right? So you all know what a bag is, right? What's a bag? Students should be able to answer this. What's a bag versus a set? What is the difference between a bag and a set? Why is it a bag? You should know that.
A multi-set can be called.
Yeah. You can have duplicate elements, right? That's what you want. A set count. So That's why it's a bank. All right. So every business entity is identified by a key, right? Everything has a key, right? So this is also identified uniquely by a key. Then there can be discovery URLs. How do I find this business? I'm going to list it in my discovery URL. You should relate this back here. So the discovery URLs is upfront, right? The topmost entity is there. So this is just an example. Is that there's a discovery URL, which is some example.com business keys this blah blah blah. And then it will actually, if you say home page, then it will return this particular URL that you would have registered. So I can say get back the home page of this business entity from UDDI. Right. And then it can have multiple names. So the fonts don't appear here. But so these are, if the name were to be in, somebody from Japan were to read this, the Japanese version of the name. And so you can have Unicode representations that are stored in here, blah, blah, blah. In English, it is called Nippon Flowers, whatever, right? So it's an alternative name, maybe NF for this and so on, right? And then you can have descriptions in many different languages. Right, so you can have a description of what is it that I do as a business, whatever, in many different languages. So what are these identifiers and categories, right? The identifier will basically say, you know, how do I want to be known in terms of not a name, but any other identifiers that are out there. SAP AG is one for SAP, and so on. And you can have a set of these. This is a bag, so you can have a whole bunch of these, each one having a different key value. The identifier bag is not as important as probably the category bag, right? So here we are saying that we are an ISO 3166 organization. It's a category, it's a categorization, right? Which can be formally explored. Now in the description also you might say that I'm an ISO 9001 organization. I do this, whatever, whatever. But this is a more formal description in XML of the categorization itself, right? This is the T model key for that categorization, right? The T model will actually break up that categorization into greater detail somewhere. But just looking at the T model key, you can kind of make out that, you know, this is providing a categorization where I am recognized as an ISO 3166 company. So in other words, if there are different ISO standards, I may belong to one or more of these standards, right? That's what you can belong to many different categories at the same time. Any entity can belong to different categories. Category bag is actually not specific to a business entity, but it will be present for many other entities here as well, as we'll see. Yeah. No, no. A T model is just a technical model, right? So for example, the abstract portion of your WSDL would be a T model. For example, right? So it's not a category. A T model will simply capture technical details about the category ISO 3166. Right? Whatever that happens to be. What does that mean? I don't know. 3166, I'm not familiar with that standard, but whatever that happens to be. So in the case of a T model for service descriptions, it would actually capture the fact that it offered these operations, blah, blah, blah. Right, that would be the T model. So it would be equivalent to the abstract portion of your WSDL on the other side. Wait, hold on. Are you clear first? Okay, so it's not a category. First throw that notion out of your mind. Okay, so it, by itself it is not a category. Every category can be described by a T model. Will probably be described T model, which give you the technical details of the category. Several categories. No, no, no. Each category will be described by a T model because it is going to have to be uniquely described. Unless there is a general category called ISO, right? And so many, under that there may be many different T models corresponding to 3166, 9001, 2001, whatever, right? So that is possible.
Can you give example, say, category is a different than the T model?
No, no, T model is the underlying basis for everything in UDDI.
Okay.
right? You will describe a service using a T model, you will describe a category using a T model, anything if you want to give a technical description of, you will use a T model instance. So it's an underlying concept that is not tied to a category. It's not saying, but the category is described, just like a service is described using a T model, the category can also be described using a T model instance.
Like, PO is a category, but...
No, PO is not a category. A category would be things like, you know, I'm a florist as opposed to I'm a manufacturer of some kind. I sell something versus I make something.
Yeah.
That's a notion of a categorization.
Finance is a category, but within...
Finance is a category.
Various domains. Within finance, we can have multiple...
You can have specializations of that categorization. T models will be corresponding to say I will allow you to trade stocks online through my bank. There will be a T model for that operation of online trading.
So within a category we can have multiple T models.
See, these are orthogonal concepts. They are kind of cutting across each other. They are orthogonal concepts.
Just like a 802.3 is a IEEE standard, then 802.3 11G or
11B. Right.
Like,
so those are all specific standards corresponding to some category of standards which describe wireless connectivity.
Yes.
That's it.
Yeah.
Right. So that's similar notion here. So the category and a specific service that is offered have nothing to do with each other. So I belong to some category. I also offer these services. I could just as easily place myself under the florist category and offer online trading services. I just do it wrong, but I can do that.
A specification.
Right?
Huh? A specification.
T-model
is a specification for this.
T-model is a... I will show you an example of a T-model document, an XML document that shows a T-model, right? We'll come back to this question once we see that and see whether it clears your doubt or not.
Sir.
Yeah. One of you, go ahead.
Is it that okay? A category is described by a T model. Now inside that category, there might be several services, and each of these services might also be described by a T model. So it is not.
Yes. Yes. Exactly. You got that. All right. Excellent. Yes. Previously. All right.
So when we say that T model is equal to this. So then what is?
It's a key. I am giving additional information. The T model key has to be unique. The key name might be the same in many different places. But
key value could also be the same.
What we are worried about is a specific key. That has to be unique. Because that uniquely identifies the T model entity that is out there. That is our main worry. Don't necessarily need to worry about the others too.
Extra information that we
provide. In many cases, it's optional. The key is compulsory. You have to provide. The others are optional. Okay. So this is just contacts. Remember, every business entity can have contacts within it. A contact is described by people, by phone numbers, by emails, addresses. Every address is composed of a bunch of lines and it describes an address line. I mean, this is a standard notion of a contact that you've come across in Facebook and everywhere else, you know, LinkedIn and whatever else. Right? So it's similar model, exactly the same model. So T model key, so this is the notion of a key reference that we are using, is a required reference to some T model that represents the identifier. So it may be an identifier code, geographical category, whatever, right? And we'll see examples of this as well. The other two are, it's an optional description of this identifier, like we said, and that's also there. So the overall system has to have some value for that key eventually, somewhere. Right, is what I think. If we see a complete example, it may be a better thing. Okay, what is this trying to say? This is saying that there is some kind of a let's say this is a business entity, right? So there is a T model key that says that the categorization group that I'm going to use is described by some WGS84, which is an encoding standard for latitude and longitude encoding, as it turns out. In a GIS way. So I can actually say my business is headquartered in this latitude and longitude, you know, instead of just saying New York, where in New York, I don't know, right? So, so the keyed reference basically says that, so this is composed of two different things, that's why it's a categorization group. It's composed of two different things. One represents latitude, one represents longitude, and specific key values are also given for this. Right? So I correspond to this key model of latitude, but the value for latitude is this. Right? So that's what I am giving here. Right? So the name is actually irrelevant for me in this particular case. It's just a human readable name. But the value is necessary because just giving a T model would imply that I'm compliant with that model of latitude, but what is the latitude I am at, we don't know, right? So somewhere in the system this key value has to be present for this particular person using this T model instance, right, and trying to identify themselves. Yeah. Yes.
So if I want to define, for example, we are defining the location or geographical location standards for the entire county. So I will give reference to that and then see that is, within that this is the value which it is.
Yeah, so WGS 84 basically says you got to have a latitude and longitude. That's what WGS 84 is saying, and there is a particular way of encoding that also. I'm not an expert on GIS myself, but that's what I believe. In fact, we are also doing a small project for the Department of Science and Technology here, where we are helping this organization called NSDI. I don't know whether you heard about it, the National Spatial Data Infrastructure, store some of their information in spatial databases. And I've come across this term there as well. It's basically a way of encoding latitudes and longitudes, is what I understand, right? Okay, so we'll see some more T model examples as we go along here. Okay. So this is a business service as opposed to a business entity, right? We saw business entity, we saw contacts, then we saw this is a business service. A service also has a name, a description, many different binding templates, a category to which this service belongs, multiple categories to which this service belongs, and signatures. Right? So the service key attribute has to uniquely identify it, supplied by UDDI if it is not supplied by the publisher. That's what we mean by optional. So something will be put in there when you stick such a service description or business service into UDDI directory. So we'll see an example rather than go through this. The gray is visible. Yes, good. Okay. So there is a service key for some business service. This happens to be a stock quote service. This is a name. Some English language description is given. Several different binding templates can exist for this service. So every binding template will have an access point, which is a URL, etc. So that's what is given out here. And it says that the service for which this binding template is going to serve is referred to by some T model key that I have not specified in this document, right? So that's one example. We have other examples here as well. So binding template, the main things that are important in the binding template is what is the access point, right? A hosting redirector, somebody will receive a SOAP message and direct it to the appropriate implementation. But the access point is what is important in here, right? So here is an example of a category bag for binding templates. Now, as opposed to a category bag for the services themselves, right? So the service could be categorized, the business can be categorized, the binding template can be categorized, and so on. This is an example where it's a test or production template. In other words, if you send a message to this, it's still in test, so you may or may not get replies. So whatever that might mean, right? So you could have different versions of this also. So you, for example, you can say that there's going to be three different binding templates. one of which is a gold binding template, one of which is a silver, and one of which is a bronze. It represents different quality of service categories that are being offered to the consumers. So if you use this binding template, you will probably have to pay more, but you'll get better services. That's what it means. We had actually seen this example earlier as well. So the binding template was the same thing that was used in the previous service that we described, which was a stock quote service. Right. So the T models are basically the technical model that underlies pretty much everything in UDDI. Right. So whatever you want to describe technically, formally, will be described using a T model. Right, and you can have many different ways of finding these T models with fine qualifiers. So for example, I'll be able to sort by date ascending is one such qualifier that you can give it. So if this T model exists, and many instances of this T model exists, I'll be able to sort these by date ascending is what this is saying. So there can be many qualifiers so that it will help people search on the other side. So I can say here is a set of fine qualifiers that I want you to use when you're searching for some information in UDDI. And that information also, some aspect of the search also has to be described in that search message. Right? We'll see an example of that. So here is the T model structure. It will have one name. It may have many descriptions, may not have any descriptions. It will have what are called overview docs. In fact, your WSDL is captured as a overview doc. So if there is a WSDL file that is located somewhere, I can stick the URL of that WSDL file in here. And therefore, I can return the URL of the WSDL by looking at this information for a service from UDDI. Right?
Sir,
yeah.
Similar to T model structure, is there any scope to have a semantic model of that service? Can we include it in this?
This is being extended as we speak. Whatever semantic metadata has to be captured for here is the T model is being extended. So we don't want to have something different because you want to have backward compatibility with existing UDDI entities. So this is being extended.
T model
structure is being extended. So this is a pictorial representation of exactly the same thing. So here is an example of a T model, right? So T model for the stock quote service. It basically says here's a description, WSDL description of a standard stock quote service interface. That's your English language description. It's not meant for machine consumption. The overview doc is important for us because it actually gives the URL of where the WSDL is located, right? And then the category bag for this can be financial services or whatever, right? So we have not actually identified a specific category bag in here, but it could be one for financial services that you will end up creating. So the previous questions with respect to categories and T models, is that a little clearer? Pardon? The T model is the one that will actually has this information about where the WSDL is.
Description.
The description is, it's just an English language description. If some human wants to, remember, UDDI can be used in two ways. One is you can write a UDDI browser that will allow people to browse it, or it's meant for program-to-program communication, where you do a search, programmatically do a search and return information, in which case it is going to ignore the description field completely. So they made it very general. They said if you want to build a browser and let humans look at it, look at it. So that way I'll allow you to write a description that can be displayed on a web page. Right? So if you write a JSP which is going to display things on a web page, the JSP can actually parse this particular field and say here's the description, stick it in a table or something like that. It is W3C itself. There is these OWLS extensions that are being done, and it's not just going to affect UDDI, it's going to affect a whole lot of other things as well, standards, right? So your WSDL also will get affected, your WSDL standard, because now you're going to have to describe semantic metadata about the service. So many things are being impacted by OWLS. So there is a committee that is looking after extensions to WSDL to support OWLS, committee that looks after extensions to this to support OWLS, and so on. So it has many implications.
Can we have multiple WSDL file in a single team?
Why would you want to do that? In theory, yes, but why would you want to do that? No, but why, what would it represent is the question. You want a T model to uniquely identify some abstract capability, in this case, some service.
But for a common kind of a service, like florist only, all the florists, if they work in a uniform manner, they have got a common interface, same interface.
Huh.
But WSDL file could be different, something like that.
No. The WSDL file will define how you write your client. Your, the way that you programmatically write your client, right? Yesterday you saw this.
Yes.
Right? Your client is tied to that WSDL description intimately. So your client would have to change the WSDL changes.
Okay.
Sir,
again there is some confusion. Can you please repeat again the difference between categories and team
models? So the category is also captured by T model. That's one point that I wish to make, right? So the description of the category is also captured by a T model somewhere. That's one thing. See, in fact, you can see here in this category bag, you have one keyed reference, which is another T model key that is given to something else, right? A T model is just a way of capturing technical information about anything within UDDI. That this is what you have to keep in mind. Anything, businesses, business entities, location information, you know, service descriptions, all of them is captured within the notion of a T model. A T model is like a class for you, right, in object oriented design. The notion of a class, if I write different classes, they will capture the semantics of what that class represents.
What can be instances of this class?
Pardon?
What can be called as instances of this T model?
So you will give a particular key value and say that key value can be interpreted in the light of the T model description that I'm giving you. It's like a template, yeah, with values have to be filled in that are given by the key value information when you use a keyed reference, right? So we... Hold on, let's answer this one question once. Unless you're going to clarify that. Okay, excellent. Then you can do it. All right. Adding to that, all right, fine. Do it anyways.
Florist.
Yes.
We take that as category, as you have said.
Okay.
There will be a T model,
right,
describing it, technically describing it.
Okay.
Correct? That's what we have.
Right.
Now, we say orchids.
Right.
Something else. So there will be, suppose, these are the categories, subcategories, suppose.
Okay.
You take that subcategories. So there will be T models for these subcategories also.
Yes.
Okay. Now, when services are written, services will have its own T category.
Services will have its own T model.
Yeah,
the service T model actually corresponds to the WSDL that you are going to give it.
So there will be different WSDL now.
Yes.
So I have one for orchid, one for something.
Yeah,
something.
There is no WSDL for a florist service because there is no florist service. There is only a service corresponding to an orchid and other things. So the florist category is an abstract category that you have created.
Yes.
That you can say in your orchid service, orchid selling service, that it also corresponds to this category. You can correspond to multiple categories, right?
Yes, yes.
So that's
there,
what
there are number of WSDL now.
Yes.
That are coming into picture.
Right.
And the category that is there, that was florist.
That's fine. So every WSDL can have multiple categories, or every service can have multiple categories.
So then
right?
Multiple WSDL.
No, no multiple WSDL for the, see, I am a service, I am going to sell florists, I mean, I am going to sell orchids, okay, I am going to put out a service that sells orchids. I have a WSDL description that I am going to put out there into UDDI, and I will say that I belong to category orchids, I belong to category flowers, I belong to category Valentine Day gifts, whatever it is that you want to think about here, right? So you can have number of category descriptions so that when somebody is searching by category description, I am looking for a Valentine's Day gift for my girlfriend, then your name will also pop up as a person selling orchids. That is the notion of categories, right? But I say the services that will, that are to be returned to me that sell orchids, if I look for that, right, If I look for all services in this category, then it will maybe return a bunch of florists back to me. Somebody who sells orchids, somebody who sells other things too. Right? So the category is just a tag that I'm going to stick onto it to say that if somebody is searching for information by category, then you can also include me in this search, the results of the search.
So when we search,
right,
we are going to T model for searching. Technical description is
there? Eventually the technical description has to be returned to the person to make use of that information. Not the technical description about the category is not important, but certainly about the service is important. And if I didn't have technical information about the service, which is a WSDL file, I cannot contact the service at all. And I also need the technical information about the binding template in this particular case. So I need, you know, two things. I need the WSDL, right? And I need the binding as to where is this service available, what is the access information or the binding template is required. Two pieces of information required.
The search will go to all WSDL.
It depends on what you are searching for. The search won't search the WSDL itself, right? It will just search the categories. Yeah. Search won't actually, see, the WSDL may not be stored within UDDI. It's a URL that is stored within UDDI eventually. That is why UDDI never, today UDDI is not used to return the WSDL. It is used to return a URL of a WSDL. Preferably the WSDL is kept with the service provider. So when you return a URL of a WSDL, that URL will refer to the service provider. So you hit that to get the WSDL back. Right? Remember the diagram that we wrote out yesterday morning for SOAP interaction. Okay? So we said the interaction looks something like this. So there is a service provider and a consumer, right, and there is a registry. This person publishes information about services in this registry, right, this is one. Then two, he searches the registry and gets information back. The information that is returned is a URL of a WSDL. Right? It can contain the WSDL too, but typically it doesn't store the WSDL. Typically the WSDL is still here. Right? Then he says, go get me the WSDL so that I can understand exactly how to invoke this service. Right? So this is WSDL query, it returns a WSDL, and then you invoke the service and then there is a response. This is the picture we saw yesterday. So there is no notion of searching the WSDL file here. You are searching based on certain categorizations that you have done within UDDI, or certain tags that you have. You can think of it as a tag. A category is like a tag that I am going to attach to it. Right? I can attach many tags to myself. Right? So I can attach, suppose I am an IIT and I am teaching. Right? I can say that I want to advertise myself as a service provider, and I do many things. You know, one of the things I do is offer CEP courses. So I'll be a CEP course provider tag that I'm going to stick to myself. Then I do consulting with many companies. So I'll say consultant, IT consultant, and I'm going to stick that tag, right? So all of these tags can be attached to me, right? Depending on also, if I want to describe myself fully, I may stick other tags. You know, I'm a father of two children, so I'll say father tag, blah blah blah. So if somebody is searching for fathers within IIT, they'll find me, right? If somebody is searching for CEP teachers in India, they'll probably find me. So there are all these tags that are stuck to me. That is the notion of category, right? Eventually, if they want to find services that are being provided by me, they'll have to get back the WSDL or the URL of the WSDL, right? And that is contained within a T model description of the service, which is a technical description of the service.
So different service providers want to register in the same category can adopt different T models.
The category itself is uniquely described by a T model. One T model. It will become a different category if it is a different T model. Yeah.
Then service can have different T models in that case, finally.
Pardon?
Service, we had seen the relationship.
Service cannot have different T models, it can have different categories, each one of which has a different T model. That is the difference.
So So finally it means that
no, the WSDL is the same. The WSDL, the T model describing the actual technical description of the service is the same. The category T models are different. There is a big difference between the two things. Right? Big difference, yes.
Like, I take a live example. Yes. Common to citizen services, GTC services, and category issue of certificates. Now, there are 20 type of certificate, death certificate, birth certificate, domicile certificate, caste certificate. How, now, under this category, I have so many. So, I will have various T models for each of the issue of the certificate, or it will be one category. Like, category is the issue of certificate, citizen certificate. But I have death certificate, birth certificate, caste certificate, marriage certificate. How
those are different services, all of which will be tied to one category of issue of whatever certificates that you called.
You can have common category, citizen
service. Can have a common category, exactly.
But citizen
service. All of them may be sharing a common category in this case. Perfectly okay to do that. Right?
So where is the T model?
the category citizen services, what does it mean is described in a T model. What does citizen services mean is described in a T model.
So, correct. I'm
that's what.
There's a one-to-one relation.
One-to-one.
Yes.
But when we saw that T model description
yeah.
Slide, there was a WSDL also coming in.
The WSDL URL was in there.
WSDL URL is related to the service.
This is access point. Is this what you're referring to?
Yeah, so now it is T model description. And here the visual the URL is also coming into picture.
So this is T model for service.
This is the T model. This contains the visual URL.
Now what we have now described was we have a service. It has a tag called as a category.
Yes.
And that category will have a T model.
That is a different T model.
Different
the category T model description is a different T model. This is a service T model that is also refers to categories, each one of which has a T model.
This is
a
service T model.
That's right.
That's what he was asking.
Yeah,
service
yeah.
has a T model or not?
It does. Everything has a T model in UDDI. Everything. Business entity, service, categories, everything is a T model. And that's why I said it is the basis of all of UDDI. It underlies everything that's going on within UDDI. So technical fingerprint, as they called it. Okay. Keys, we don't have to worry about specifically how the keys are generated for you.